But we are excited about being back out tonight. We have been just seeking the Lord throughout the afternoon about a word. And as we prayed and we prayed and we prayed as we got closer to coming, God began to stir in our spirit a word that I believe that he wants you to hear tonight. And, you know, like we said the other night, you need a now word. You need a today word. You don't need a tomorrow word. We ain't ready for that yet. You need a now word. All right, yesterday, that was yesterday. Amen. And I hear y'all had an awesome service here yesterday and especially last night and had an opportunity to partake in communion. And the Holy Spirit just fell upon this house and y'all experienced the joy in the Holy Ghost, as it was said there just a minute ago. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, what that tells us, church, is God's real. I mean, you can feel him. I'm glad that I'm saved by grace through faith. And you know, my faith is not based upon what I feel as far as where I stand, but I'm so glad I got what I'm so glad I can feel what I've got. Amen. That God is real. And so something that I've not done yet, that I just kind of feel led to do this, is that some of you know this, and Brother Brian may practice this year, and that's good too. We're just going to come along beside of him. But some of you are familiar with what I'm about to do. And so I just want to ask you a question. Do you want to spend 10 seconds, the best time you could ever spend on this side of eternity? How many of you want to spend 10 seconds of the best time you could ever spend on this side of eternity? So you have to stand with me, all right? You're going to have to stand with me. And for the next 10 seconds, I'm going to count. And then you're going to have to do some shouting, do some clapping, do some stomping, do some dancing. I don't care if you got to get up in the chair, amen. I mean, we are just going to have 10 seconds of some just wonderful Holy Ghost fun. Can we do that? You going to work with me on this? All right, 1,001, 1,002, 1,003, 1,004, 1,005, 1,006, 1,007, 1,010, hallelujah, hallelujah, woo, don't that make you feel better already, yeah, praise the Lord, woo, glory, glory, woo, man, I like that, amen. That's a little bit of a sound to what it sounds like when a sinner comes into the kingdom of God. The Bible says there's joy in the presence of the angels over every sinner that repenteth. Yes, praise the Lord. And you know what? That just might be a similar sound that we'll experience when we cross over Jordan into that heavenly home, that the saints that went on before us will be there just to welcome us in with a hand clap, open arms, and celebration. That another one of God's people made it home. So praise the Lord. Well, I want you to get your Bibles out tonight, and I want you to turn with me to two portions of Scripture. The first one being John chapter number 12, which is where we'll do the bulk of the message this evening. But then the other one out of 1 Corinthians chapter number 15. John chapter number 12 and 1 Corinthians chapter number 15. Now, as we've shared with you, and as you already know, first fruits is an offering. It is an offering. And see, somehow you and I have got to get to a place, I want you to remember this, that we turn our sacrifices into offerings. Because see, if you are in the service, and I don't say for the Lord, but also with the Lord, because we're with him. Right. We're with God. I don't work for him. I work with him. We need to understand that. We work with him. He's empowered us with the Holy Spirit. But we know this, that if we are going to serve with God, that it is going to cost us something. And there's going to be a sacrifice involved. But there has to come a time when you and I understand that we need to start turning our sacrifices into offerings. That we are turning something that we are giving, we are investing in, turning it from a sacrifice into an offering. That's how you move from, you move into a place of celebration when it comes to serving with God and giving to God. And that when somebody calls upon you to give, whether it be an offering or whether it be an offering of your money or your tithe or your talents, it doesn't become a burden. It doesn't become a fear that, hey, you ready to give. Because see, like we shared with you Saturday night, God wants us to learn to live to give. Learn to live to give. We're to be givers. It is more blessed to than to. And that's a great lesson, parents, that we should teach our children. I mean, because, I mean, our children, especially in our culture here in America, got about everything that they could possibly want. And you and I are trying to come up with imagining new ways that we can get our kids something new for Christmas because they've already got everything else. Right? We do that. When we need to begin to teach them to learn to, that the blessing of being a giver, learning to give. And like I said before, you and I also got to get to the place that we want the blesser more than we want the blessing. We want God more than what God can give us. Amen? We got to want Him for the right reasons. So I want you to look with me, first of all, as we'll look in 1 Corinthians chapter number 15, and then we'll come back to the book of John chapter number 12. But the Bible says in this portion of Scripture, it says, I want you to look at me in verse number 20. It says, but now is Christ risen from the dead and become the firstfruits of them that what? That slept. Those that slept. Now, for us as believers, we know that death has no power over us. That when you and I die, we sleep in Jesus. Don't ever forget that. We sleep in Jesus because death has no power over us. Jesus conquered death, hell, and the grave and took the keys away from the devil. So death has no power. So when you and I, our body ceases to function, it just sleeps. And it sleeps. And we know that one day that they'll put that body in the ground and it's going to sleep until resurrection morning. There's going to come a day that there's going to be a shout, a voice, and a trump. And the Bible says that body's going to come back out of that ground and it's going to be reunited with that soul and that spirit that has went on to heaven that for those that believe, and it's going to be reunited. And I believe that you'll be able to go to every graveyard and know who exactly was saved. Because the top's going to be blown off the graves, amen? I believe that with all that's in me. You'll be able to go and say, yeah, that one was saved. The grave is empty. Why? Because it's where Jesus was at. It's empty. And you'll know. You'll also know those that maybe said they were saved and wasn't saved. And, uh-oh. I mean, the top's still on their grave. Now, many, many, the Bible says, will say unto me, Lord, Lord, did we not do many things in thy name? And he said, depart from me, ye that work iniquity. I never knew you. But it says here in verse number 20 that Jesus is the first fruits of them. And I told you the other night that Jesus is a type of first fruit. He is a first fruit. There's been several people that have died and been resurrected. But they had to die again. Jesus is the only one that died and was resurrected and is still alive. He's at the right hand of God the Father making intercession for us. And so we have a God. Yes, give God a hand. He's worthy. So he has a body, a resurrected body. He's at the right hand of God the Father. When you and I pray, we have a Savior that knows what we're going through. See, we have a Savior that knows what Brother George is going through. We have a Savior that knows the struggle that's going on in his physical body and in his mind. We have a Savior that understands what's happening to him right now. So we have a Savior that can relate to us when we go through our struggles and we go through our pains and our sufferings and we have our highs and our lows. We have a God. Why? He's the first fruits. He's the first fruits. Now, I want you to look down as we'll just continue reading. But it says, for since by man came death, by man also came the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. But every man in his own order. Look at there. But every man in his own order. So when you hear somebody say that you and I have a death appointment, it's appointed unto man once to die after this to judgment, and their day is a day set. We know the Bible says we can lengthen those days or shorten those days. We can. One of those ways, children, is by honoring your parents. You can shorten your life by dishonoring your parents. Or you can lengthen your life by honoring your parents. Read the scriptures. You can make your days longer upon this earth. The Bible goes on in the Word and it says, but every man in his own order, Christ the first fruits, afterward they that are Christ at his coming. Then cometh the end, when he shall have delivered up the kingdom of God, even the Father, when he shall have put down all rule and all authority and power, for he must reign till he hath put all enemies under his feet. And then the Bible says here in Scripture that the last enemy that shall be destroyed is what? The last enemy that God is going to destroy is death. So death is real. It's real. It is an entity. It is a principality. There's an angel of death. The Bible talked about that. So the Bible, and we know that Satan is the author of confusion, but we also know that he's a liar, a murderer, a thief, and he's the father of all those things. That's what the Word says. Now, as we read down, look what it says also. It says in verse number 26, the last enemy that shall be destroyed is death. For he hath put all things under his feet, but when he saith all things are under him, it is manifest that he is accepted, which did put all things under him. And when all things shall be subdued unto him, then shall the Son also himself be subject unto him that put all things under him, that God may be all in all. So we look at this scripture now. Before we move any farther, just go back to chapter number 11. Chapter number 11. And I apologize, Brother Aaron, for not getting this scripture to you. But we also know, look with me in chapter number 11, where we read the scriptures concerning communion. And y'all had communion last night. The Bible says in verse number 23, for I have received, chapter 11, verse 23, for I have received the Lord, that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also he took the cup, which he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show what? Ye do show what? The Lord's death till he come. You to show the Lord's death till he come. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for your precious word. And we ask you right now, Lord, just to help us to preach this word. We want to preach this word in the power of the Holy Spirit. And we want these wonderful folks here to get a greater grasp of what it means, Lord, for us to bring our first fruits and to also understand first fruits, dear God. We want them to understand that they're gathering this week and they're being imparted much wisdom. You are downloading into their spirit, dear God, from your word that's helping them to grow, Lord, to become the men and the women and the sons and the daughters that they need to be. And so, Lord, tonight, as we are open and exposed to you, every one of us is in this church house right now, Lord, we are open and exposed. I pray that right now during this prayer, that if there's sins that need to be confessed, that they're confessing them, Lord Jesus. If there's sins that need to be forsaken, they're forsaking them right now, dear God. If there's anything in their heart and their life that they need to surrender to you, they need to do it right now. Right now, dear God, while we're in this prayer and in this prayer of agreement, because your word says that whatever we bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, whatever we loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven, that where two or three agree as touching any one thing that they shall ask of the Father, it shall be done, that where two or three are gathered together in your name, Lord, you're in the midst. You're in the midst. And so, Lord, we just want to kind of lay this out simple for them tonight to help them to understand something, that Christ is the first fruits. Christ is the first fruits. And Lord, as we looked at that scripture about communion, you said that we are to remember your death till you come. And Lord, the reason why we remember your death is that it reminds us that we need to continue to die. We need to continue to die to self and let you rule and reign in our mortal bodies. Lord, I pray tonight. Many say, Lord, Lord, but they don't know you as Lord. They know you as Savior, but they don't know you as Lord. And you said one day that every knee is going to bow and every tongue is going to confess that Jesus is Lord. And Lord, I know the other day I kind of shared something with these folks about those on the outside of the city in heaven. Those on the outside, they never made you Lord while they were here. They were saved and they made it to there, but they had never made you Lord yet. And dear God, I'm convinced in my heart that there's many in this house. They know you as Savior, but they don't know you as Lord. And Lord, so I pray tonight that they'll understand that they have got to give you that place in their heart. They have got to give you that throne in their life. They have got to allow you to rule and reign in this mortal body. They have got to allow you to live through them to accomplish the work that you need done on this earth today. Today. Lord, this is our time on the stage of eternity right now. Lord, you didn't call Peter, James, and John for this time. You call me and everybody else in this building. So we are a chosen generation, the Word says. So Lord, I count that a great honor and a privilege. And Lord, that would have been a great blessing to have been alive when the church was birthed into existence. Lord, we're living in even a more exciting time that we could see the church taken out of here in a moment of a twinkling of an eye. And so Lord, with that type of knowledge and that type of understanding, then dear God, we know that I just really believe in my heart that you're going to hold us to a greater accountability than you did even the early disciples. Because, God, we have got the wealth of resources of knowledge and information from the last 2,000 years to help us to be the best men and women of God than any generation before us. So, Lord, I pray today that every one of us would understand this great responsibility which we have. It's not a burden. It's a great responsibility, and that's what I count it. Because, Lord, I know this, that cross wasn't a burden to you. It was a responsibility. You went to the cross of Calvary. You died for our sins, and you paid a debt we could not pay. So help us tonight, Lord, as we preach this word. We need you tonight. We pray for the lost to be saved. We pray for the backslider to be restored. We pray for the sick to be healed. We pray for the bound to be delivered. Because, Lord, I know this, that if the enemy had any way to slip in here tonight, somebody brought him in. So we rebuke him right now in the name of Jesus Christ. And we cast him outside the property here. He don't have no place in here. Lord, no place. This is holy ground. Holy ground, holy ground. And, Lord, they sung about the mercy seat. We talked about the mercy seat even just the other night, being the center of the basketball court. Oh, that's where the cross is at. So, Lord, tonight, I know this has been a long prayer, but we need it, Lord. Lord, we need to know how to learn how to pray some long prayers. Not some of those little 5-minute prayers, but we need to learn to pray those long prayers. We just dig deep. Dear God, we reach deep, Lord Jesus, that we just want to communicate with you. We want to talk with you, Lord. We want to release some things, dear God. We want to do that tonight. And so we pray. And ask all these things in your holy and precious name, Lord Jesus. Yes, and all of God's children said, Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Now, go with me to the book of John chapter number 12. I read those other scriptures to build a foundation of what we want to preach tonight. Christ is the first fruits. Christ died so that you and I could live. Christ died so that our sins could be forgiven. And that when Christ instituted communion, he didn't institute communion to cause us to run from him, but to run to him. Now, I was brought up in a conservative Baptist background, very conservative, that they preached communion so hard that you was about half scared to death to take it. And they only done it once a year, maybe, at the most once a year. And then when they did have it, everybody was so scared, nobody wanted to take it. Amen. So we thought the preacher was super holy and the deacons had to be super holy and the rest of us were heathens. Amen. I mean, time they got done, you was afraid to take communion. But God never meant it to be that way. God instituted communion not for us to run from him, but to run to him. Because if I've got some stuff going on that I know that I can't get out of my life, then I got to get to somebody that can. Now, if I refuse to take communion and I've got that stuff in my life, then I'm telling God I love that stuff more than I love Him. I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to love my sin more than I love my God. Because then that sin will be elevated to become my God. So we have to keep things in a proper priority. We have to do that. But Jesus said this. He said, as often as you do this in remembrance of me, but remember my death till I come. Remember that. So that when you and I go up and we take communion, it reminds us, Jesus died, so I got to die. Jesus died, so I got to die. So every time I go to communion, it's like, okay, Lord, what do I need to die to now? Because when you think that you run out of things to die to, you just began. Because it seemed like every time you get close to God, He'll begin to show you things that you need to get out of your life. He'll begin to show you things that you need to die to that are not only becoming a stumbling block to you, but stumbling block to other people. And so what is it? Jesus said, be ye holy, for I am holy. So how do I become holy? By dying to self. See, holiness is not a denomination, contrary to what a lot of people think. Holiness is a biblical doctrine. Holiness is a biblical principle. And if I can define holiness, it's very simple. This is it. Separated from sin and dedicated to God. Holiness, very simply defined, separated from sin, dedicated or devoted to God. Let me ask you, do you fit in that category now? Do you fit in that category as we are in church tonight? Now, if you've got a pen and piece of paper, I want you to write these four things down. And these four things are going to help you tonight. Now, this is another portion of Scripture that is familiar to each and every one of us. But this is a Scripture in the New Testament where Jesus gives us a prime example of first fruits. A prime example of what first fruits means. Prime example. Look with me here. You remember what I said? The first, when they went into the promised land, the first crop that they grew, the very first part of that crop belonged to God. So then they harvested the crop. Their family could not partake of the crop. But until they took the first part, the tenth, the tithe, to the priest, and they offered it up to God. And then when that offering went up, it became a wave offering. A wave offering. Not to boast about how much they were blessed, but to boast on how big God is because of how much He provided. Amen? When we get to understand first fruit. Now, there's one thing that to always remember when I think about lifting my hands up to God like this, you know, when I begin to ask God to pour something down on me or rain something down on me, I like to form a funnel. Amen? I like to form a funnel. Sometimes I need a bigger funnel. Amen? Whatever God wants to give, I mean, I'm willing to adjust to whatever's coming down as long as God pours it in. Now, look with me in verse 23. In this scripture, the theme is the Messiah teaches. The word Messiah means anointed, the anointed one. It says, and Jesus answered them, saying, the hour has come that the Son of Man should be glorified. The Bible says here, verily, verily, I say to you, except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit. He that loveth his life shall lose it, and he that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto life eternal. If any man serve me, let him follow me, and where I am, there also my servant be. If any man serve me, him will my Father honor. Now is my soul troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour, but for this cause came I unto this hour. Now, I'm not going to have you to raise your hands, but I am going to allow God to use me tonight to put you on the spot. And how that I'm going to do that is this. Don't raise your hand, but I just wonder how many people in this section have led somebody to Jesus. I'm talking about just one person to Jesus. Now, God knows how many people you have led to the Lord. And it's not an age thing. I mean, I have worked with little children her age that have led classmates to Jesus. Shame adults at times. Now, this section, I just wonder how many of you in this section have led at least one person to Christ? At least one person you've led to Christ. Like I said, I'm not going to have you lift your hands, but I'm going to use this opportunity to put you on the spot. Because I can already tell there's several over here haven't led anybody to Jesus, and there's several over here ain't led nobody to Jesus. Now it's your turn. Y'all supposed to be saying you got my back, all right? Because the more I turn, the madder they get, amen? And I just wonder, now this is a pretty big crowd over here in a pretty good section. How many of you have led at least one person to Jesus? At least one person to Jesus. I'm just talking about one, amen? Now think about it. I'm coming back to you. Now, you guys are squirming a little bit, amen? I'm going to ask you the same question. You don't have to freak out. You just have to get real. But I just wonder how many in this section have led at least one person to Jesus. Now, if we have got a group of people here, and there's several in here right now that have never led anybody to Jesus, then what does that teach me, according to the scriptures, that Jesus is trying to tell us there in John chapter number 12? You have not died to yourself. You have not died to your selfish ways, your selfish desires. You've not died to them. It's been all about you. Yes, you may be saved. You may be born again. You may be on your way to heaven. But listen, you've never learned to make Jesus Lord of your life. The Bible says what we have to learn to die or we're going to remain alone. What does that tell me? That tells me that one day when I stand before Jesus, not only will I stand, and I'll give an account alone, but there's also going to be a group connected with me that were born again as a result of my ministry. There's going to be a group that come into the kingdom of God as a result of me dying to what I want to do and doing what God told me to do. And so is everyone in here that is a believer. But there's going to be a lot that will stand before God one day and try to explain to the Lord why you do not have at least one person under your belt. With the same Holy Spirit that was in Jesus, the same Holy Spirit that's in us, and we're going to be able to try to stand before God and say we didn't know how, or we couldn't do it, or we couldn't talk good enough, or we wouldn't pray it up enough, or we didn't read our Bibles enough. That don't cut it. It don't cut it. Except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it remaineth alone. See, I could take a kernel of corn and place it on a corner of this little podium right here. Could come back 10 years from now, and that thing is not sprouted. But I could take that same kernel of corn, walk out to the side of this church, open up the ground just a little bit, drop it down in there, cover it up, maybe about a couple inches, and what begins to happen? But see, what begins to happen? It starts growing before it ever bursts through the ground. It starts growing under the ground, which is a picture that you and I start growing on the inside before it ever comes on the outside. So see, there has to be a first fruit for you. There has to be a first. See, I still remember the very first person I ever led to the Lord. And it was in the Casey County Jail. And during that particular time, they used to take me in there and lock me up with them. I went back there with them. They had a room that had about 30 men, and normally it was always the bunks were full. They were laid out in a floor, and I'd have to step over bodies to try to get over to the table to preach to them. When I first went in, they ignored me. Let the TV blast. They continued to talk. You know what? I just kept on talking too. Amen. And at that time, they allowed them to smoke, and they smoked in there so heavy that nicotine was running down the walls. I'd come out of there, I smelled like smoke plumb down to my underwear. I mean, Carmen wouldn't even let me in the house. Sometimes I'd have to get naked out behind the house and then run in the house. You said too much information, Brother Jeff, but you got the point. Amen. Because, I mean, it saturated my drawers, amen. I mean, it got deep. But see how that were one is my day was Monday afternoon. And every Monday I went. Every Monday I went. And I would go. And each Monday I went, I gained a little bit of ground. And I gained a little bit of ground. Eventually, to the point some started listening. Then the majority of them started listening. Then they quit playing their poker games. Then they got up and quit. They turned the TV off. Then they started listening. Then they would say, hey, the preacher's here. I can hear him walking down the hall. Faithfulness is the key. You always honor God with your faithfulness. The Bible says without faith it's impossible to please God, but with faith all things are possible. And so I remember the very first one when I first started going to the jail. My pastor used to work the prisons in Brazil, Indiana. And so when we would go to the jails, Brother Harmon had a gift of gab. And so he'd be leading a bunch of people to the Lord, and I wasn't leading anybody to Jesus. So I'll tell you what I did. I got on my knees one night, and I said, Lord, I'm tired of my preacher leading everybody to Jesus. I want to lead somebody to Jesus. That's what I told him. I said, I'm tired of him getting all the fun. I want to get in this. I want to lead my first person to Christ. Lord, I want to do this. I walked in the jail the very next time. There was a guy come running up to me. Said, I want to get saved. Woo! Glory to God. So still, I'm a young Christian. So I'm saying, let me show you the Romans Road. And I got him down on the floor, and I'm trying to show him the Romans Road. And I'm trying to show him the Romans Road, and all of a sudden, he just started praying. Oh, Lord, I'm a sinner. I need to get saved. Lord, forgive me. And come into my heart. And I said, praise God, he's already praying. I ought to pray with him. Oh, Lord, save him. Lord, save his soul. He needs to get saved. That's exactly how it happened. I believe if you want it bad enough, God's going to give it to you, and that can be your first fruit as far as leading somebody into the kingdom of God. And there's no reason why not everybody in this building hasn't led at least one person to Christ.
Yes, sir.
Now just imagine. Statistics tell me a lot. 1 + 1 = what? 2 + 2 = what? 100 + 100 = what? 200 + 200 = what? 500 + 500 = what? Are you getting a picture? You could double your church attendance in a week's time. You could double the amount of people. See, if the church would just understand, it's not hard. If each one of us would just do our part, be a corn of wheat and fall into the ground and die, we can lead somebody to Christ. There was numerous times that I had men tell me when my pastor turned the ministry over to me, they'd say, Brother Jeff, I want to help you. I'll be there Monday night. So we'd moved it from Monday to Monday night to accommodate some of these dudes. And so I'd get home from work, and I was tired, and I was wore out, and Carmen was tired, and she was wore out. And I'd say, honey, I got to go to the jail tonight. And so she was always supportive and encouraging me and prayed for me. And I'd get there, and I'd be waiting on these other jokers. Yeah, they told me they were coming. Amen. And it's funny. They always had good excuses. They thought were good. Amen. Sometimes I think they exchanged them so they wouldn't wear one out. And so I'd be sitting there and I'd say, you know, Lord, I'm really tired. I've had a rough day. I think I'm just going to go on home. And God would speak to me sitting out in the car, the jail. And he'd say, but those men need to hear. But Lord, I'm by myself. You said I'm supposed to go with somebody. We're supposed to go two by two. He said, I'm with you. I'm with you. He said, you ain't by yourself. I'm with you. And then see, As God's working on me, He's already working on them. And so I'd be sitting there and I'd be trying to talk myself out of it, really. And God would speak to me and He said, if you go in, there'll be seven saved. I'm telling you, He would tell me numbers. And I'd come home and tell Carmen. And I'd go in and sure enough, the exact amount that God spoke to my spirit, that's what I would see get saved in the jail every time I went. And most of the time, I always done it by myself. And you know what, church? Even to this day, since I learned in the early part of my ministry to do a lot of things by myself like that, it's still hard for me at times to call upon people to help me, even though that's what God tells me I'm supposed to do. Because guess what? I've just learned to trust in Jesus. Amen. There ought to be something you should learn. I'm just trusting you, Jesus. I'm just trusting you. The Word of God says, verily, verily, I say unto you, except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth a little fruit. What does it say? It bringeth forth what? Much fruit. Point number one. Listen. We need to disown our self-oriented lifestyle, where everything is about us. Our lifestyles are self-oriented. We have turned our churches into places like that, where when we come to church, it's not about Jesus. It's about, well, do they sing the music I like? Does the preaching I like? Do they have the youth program that I need? Do they have this or do they have that? It ain't about you. It's about Jesus. It's about the Lord. That's the reason why we come. It's about Christ. You know, one day I was standing in church and I was thanking people for being there. I was thanking people for coming. The Holy Spirit spoke to me and said, why are you thanking them for being here?
That's right.
I mean, God called me out right there on the spot. I said, well, Lord, they come to church this morning. He said, they're supposed to be here.
Amen.
Why are you thanking them for coming to the house that they're supposed to be at?
Amen.
They ought to be thanking me for allowing them to have another breath of air, to get up out of the bed, to get in a warm car and drive to a church where they can be preached to. They ought to be praising me. They ought to be giving me glory. See, we have got to disown this self-oriented life that we have, where everything has to be about us, and realize when we come to God's house, it's about Him. It's about Him. It's about Him. And when we start making, Jesus said, if I lift Him up, what's going to happen? If I lift Him up, what's He going to do? Draw all men. So if I lift up Jesus and make Him Lord of my life, exalt Him, then He's going to draw people. He's going to draw people unto Him. Point one. Point two. The Bible says, he that loveth his life shall lose it. And he that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto life eternal. Now, you and I know that all of us are facing eternity. And what is 50 or 60 or 70 years compared to eternity? No comparison. None. But you and I also know that decision we make here will determine where we spend eternity. And I told you this the other night, I really believe that God is preparing us for what He is going to have us to do in eternity. Now, we're in the stages of preparation. And see, tonight you see me with jeans and a sweater on and very casual wear. That's what you see. But in the spirit, I have mantles. In the spirit, I'm dressed like a warrior. In the spirit, when the devil looks at me, he sees the battles I've fought. He sees the battles I've won. He sees the victories. He sees the scars. He sees the energy, the effort. He sees the hours of study, the hours of prayer. And he knows if he comes this way, he's going to get a fight. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
He knows he's going to not knock me over with a feather. Well, the preacher didn't say nothing to me, so I'm not coming back next Sunday. Oh, Brother Brian got all over my toes. Well, he was really aiming for your heart. He was a little short. Amen? Amen. But in the spirit, they know you. Listen to me. The enemy knows me. He knows where I've been. He knows what I've done. He knows what I've done. He knows what I've done. He knows what you've done. He knows where you've been. He knows what you've been doing. He knows what kind of temptation you succumbed to. He knows what brought you down one time can bring you down two times. He knows who to put in your path. He knows what kind of trap to lay before you. He knows why. He's already done it once and you've given into it. Oh, now, listen. He has taken a study of your life. So the sooner you make Jesus the Lord of your life, I'm going to tell you, he will think twice about messing with you. Because if he knows you know that word and you know how to use that word as a sword, you can slice him all to pieces and so he won't come around. Jesus used the word against the devil. Jesus used the word against the devil. And let me tell you, Jesus said the seed is the word. The seed is that word. So I want you to think for just a moment right now in the spirit realm. How do they see you? Weak, wimp, phony, fake, pansy, yellowback? Or do they see you strong in Christ? Do they see you mighty in the Lord? Do they see you strong in the Spirit? Do they see? Because they know. They know. You know people that have the anointing on them. You know the people that have a stronger anointing than other people have. You know. You feel it when you're around them. Why? Because of the way they are dressed in the Spirit. Amen? Amen. And see, remember Elisha wanted Elijah's mantle. He knew that Elijah had a mantle. That mantle wasn't a piece of clothing. That mantle was an anointing. And he says, I want a double anointing. But Elisha had to be there when Elijah went up to catch the double anointing. See, that's the reason why you don't ever know what you're going to miss when you don't come to church.
That's right.
You don't know what's going to be transferred. You don't know what's going to be imparted. You don't know what's going to be downloaded. So you need to stay plugged in. You need to stay plugged in. Forsake not the assembling of yourselves together as some is, as a manner of some is, but exhorting one another. Especially as you see the day approaching. The day approaching. Number two is this. The Bible teaches me that I need to have an established commitment to Christ. An established commitment to Christ. Because see, when you and I sign our name to a contract, then you have made an established commitment. So each month that bill is due. And it don't matter whether you've worked or you've not worked. It don't matter whether you're sick or whether you feel good. You have made an established commitment to a lender to borrow their money to pay them back, right? Then you and I need to make an established commitment to Christ. That come hell or high water, I'm serving Him, amen. Whether I feel good, whether I feel bad, I'm still serving Him. I don't care. I'm going to serve God. That is an established commitment. The Bible says that Jesus is the first fruits. Then you and I are going to begin to fall in order. We're going to begin to fall in order. Now, Jesus teaches us here about first fruits. About the feast of first fruit. Remember what I told you about Old Testament's prophecy? You weren't listening. Write this down. Brother Brian was listening. He gets a star. Amen. Amen. There you go. Old Testament is prophecy concealed. New Testament is what? Prophecy revealed. Jesus is the Alpha, the Omega, the first, the last, the beginning, and the ending, Genesis, Revelation, and every book in between. He is the living Word of God. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was the beginning with God, and all things were created by Him. Jesus is that Word. Amen? He's that Word. Now, the Bible teaches us in this scripture that about that first fruits. So you and I need to have an established commitment to God. The Bible says here in this Word, he that loveth his life shall lose it, and he that layeth hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto life eternal. If any man serve me, let him follow me. Let him follow me. Jesus said, I know my sheep, they hear my voice, and they... So can we truly know Jesus, but we never follow him? That's where a lot of people have bought into a false bill of goods, thinking they're saved, but they're just as lost can be, bound and damned on the way on their way to hell. Yes, sir. Because you know the proof is in the pudding. If Christ is in you, you have a desire to want to follow him. To follow him. And if you have a problem following him, then there's something wrong there. Either you're just cold and deeply backslidden, or you just never were born again to begin with. I mean, really. Church, I believe salvation can be easy, so easy that a child can understand. But I also believe that the church has got into a place where we present easy believism. Just say this little prayer and you're saved. You just do anything you want to do. You're still saved. You're still on your way to heaven. But you just do any little thing you want to do. If there is no conviction, then there is no convictor. And if there is no convictor who is the Holy Spirit, then you're lost in your trespasses and sins. And you're still on your way to hell. And that is the truth. That is the truth. If God lives inside of you, there is a supernatural desire and hunger to want to serve God. A supernatural hunger and a desire. And I'll tell you this, it's insatiable. Yeah. What did I preach to you Saturday night?
More.
Amen. Amen. Hey. He wants more. Not just a little, he wants more. The more you give him, the more he wants. And he'll give you that desire to want to give him more. More. The Bible teaches us. Let me give you point number three. It says, if any man serve me, let him follow me. And where I am, there shall also my servant be. Number three, the promise of fellowship. The promise of fellowship. The promise of fellowship. Jesus said, that if I'm like a corn of wheat and I fall into the ground and die, and if I live my life for him, then I'm going to have fellowship with him. When's the last time that you hung out with Jesus? When's the last time you hung out with him in prayer? When's the last time you felt his presence, you felt his power? When's the last time God spoke to you going down the road? When's the last time God spoke to you at the workplace? When's the last time that the Word of God jumped off the page and spoke directly to your heart and you knew it was a God-given Word just for you? The Bible teaches us very clear that you will have fellowship with Him. See, once again, I see a lot of God's people today, they might be saved, but they have not made Jesus Lord. And how I know that is that they don't fellowship with Him. And I'll tell you something. We live in a church age where it's less church, more world. Do you not see something wrong with that picture? I know most of you don't like that kind of preaching. But I'm going to tell you anyway. We need more church and less world. We need to be in God's house more. We need to be in God's presence more. We need to be in God's Word more. We need to be praying more. Not just showing up on a Sunday morning doing our little duty. Going on about Sunday afternoon the rest of the week doing whatever we want to do. That ain't biblical. That ain't biblical. That is a culture that the church has got itself caught up in. But I already said, either your church will be culturally relevant or it will be biblically relevant. And we need biblically relevant churches today in the world that we live in, because this world needs Jesus. They need the real Jesus. They need the true Jesus. Yes, and they need to see church members that have died to self. Selfish ways, selfish desires, selfish wants. Because church, it makes me mad when ball games get presidents over coming to church. Listen, some of y'all sat under my preaching. I got folks here now under my preaching, and they know I beat the fire out of them with this stuff. Amen? Amen. And I've run people off. Because, see, if we're not careful, see, I grew up, I played basketball. They didn't have games on Wednesday nights and Sundays. They didn't have them. They didn't have practices. They respected where the church stood, but the church has lost its respect because it's not standing its ground. We got to stand our ground. And that means church members have to stand their ground. That means you have to stand your ground. Because Brother Brian can preach it till his face turns blue, but you're going to do what you want to do. And you have to decide if you're going to take little Junior to the practice or take him to Sunday school. You're going to have to decide what you want to do. Amen. Amen. The Bible says that in the last days that we'd be lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. And because of that, there's a great falling away of the church. And the love of many has waxed cold. When you and I begin to give things like that preeminence in our life, we begin to drift from God. That means little Junior may not be so popular. That means little Junior might not make the team. Amen? That means little Junior might come up snotting and crying and screaming at you, say, I hate you, I hate you. Then you turn him around and you spank that bottom. Amen. You wear him out. Or her. Out. Because, see, once again, you still have that responsibility. Amen. Amen. God got y'all feeling good last night so I could come in here and smack you around. Amen. Amen. The Bible says, if any man serve me, let him follow me. And where I am, there shall my servant be. And here's the promise. This is a promise of honor. The Bible says, if any man serve him, him will my Father honor. Amen. So we have a choice. Do we want to be honored by God? Or do we want to be honored by the world? Because, see, one of my prayers this year over folks that I come into contact with and over you is that God bless you with health, wealth, favor, and honor. Yes. See, honor is one of those words that seemingly has left our vocabulary, like noble. Those things have seemingly been cast aside. And for that reason, people don't honor their vows. They don't honor their commitment. You know, it amazes me. People come and join a church, but they ain't committed to it. I don't know why they join. I'm just at a place where I'm going to make it hard for them to join. Amen? I'm going to make it hard. Because I've seen so many fly-by-nights come in. I mean, to join one Sunday, I ain't seen them suckers for a year. They done dropped off the face of the earth. They ain't died yet because I ain't seen it in the paper. I mean, I'd have heard about it if they'd have died. But I run up on them, run them every now and then, and those are the ones at Walmart. How you doing, brother? Those are the ones. Some of the ones. But see, there's honor. There's honor. The Bible teaches us that if we are a corn of wheat and we will fall into the ground and die, then God will honor us. He'll honor you as a man, as a husband, as a father. He'll honor you as a woman, a mother. He'll honor you
He'll honor you. Don't ever forget this. God honors faith. If you're faithful, God honors you. I mean, you can make a mess of everything you do, but if you're faithful, God's going to honor you. He's going to get you to the place where you quit messing it up. Because He wants to honor you. He wants to honor you. The Bible says if we lift up Jesus, He draws all men unto Him. The Bible says that we are seated in the heavenly places with Jesus. So if we lift up Jesus, He pulls us up. And then as He pulls us up, then He begins to elevate us. See, there's promotion in God's kingdom. You remember the scripture that Jesus said that there was a Roman soldier that understood the kingdom better than the children of Israel did. He likened the kingdom to a military format, meaning there's ranks, meaning there's different kinds of angels. There's just not angels. There's cherubims, there's seraphims, there's archangels, there's warrior angels, there's ministering angels. Angels that have different responsibilities. Michael, an archangel. Gabriel, a messenger angel. That's the reason why you see them used in different capacities in the scripture. When Daniel prayed and the prayer went up, who come and fought the fight? See what I'm saying? There's ranks, but there's also promotion in God's kingdom. There's promotion. With honor comes promotion. With honor comes elevation. Not only in God's kingdom, but with wisdom and knowledge. God cannot trust you with His knowledge if you can't handle it. Another time I prayed, and once again, my pastor, I loved my pastor. I mean, I loved him. I really did. I paid attention to him. I respected him. And he took me under his wing, and he taught me. He wasn't perfect, but he loved me, and I loved him. He loved me. He loved my family, and I loved him. But see, I took an opportunity to learn from him every time I could. And I remember one time, I mean, he'd be quoting Bible scriptures. We went into jail one time and we encountered this man demonly possessed with a spirit of a religious spirit. And that religious spirit could quote scripture, but the only problem was it was misquoting scripture. I mean, to all the other men in the jail, he looked like some type of a prophet, but he was a demon-possessed man. I was a young Christian. I didn't know if he was saying it right or not. But my preacher did. And we went in there. That dude stood up and started quoting all scriptures. He said, stop right there. He said, I command you to stop right there. He said, if you're going to quote that scripture, you say it right. It says it this way. That guy crumbled in a matter of seconds. He was like a dog with its tail between its legs, run over there in the corner and hid. Because, see, he come up against somebody that knew the Word. That knew the Word. And you know what? That put a hunger inside of me. And I began to pray. Remember, I said, Lord, I want to win somebody to Jesus. I'm getting tired of Brother Hartman having all the fun. Then I began to pray, and I said, Lord, I want to understand my Bible like my preacher does.
Yes, sir.
How many of you prayed that prayer lately? Amen. I want to understand the prayer like the Bible like my mama does, like my grandmama does. I want to understand the prayer like my grandpa does, my youth pastor does. I want to understand the Bible the way they understand it. Listen, the Bible says, you have not because you ask not. But if you ask believing, you're going to receive. And I remember getting down and praying, and God spoke to me. I said, Lord, I want to understand the Bible like my preacher. And God says, you already do. Did I hear that right, Lord? You already do. I said, I don't understand. Well, what do you mean? He said, is not my Holy Spirit in you? I go, yes. Is not my Holy Spirit all knowledgeable and all knowing? Yes. Is not my Holy Spirit in you? Yes. Then that means all knowledge is already in you.
That's right.
It's already in you, but you got to cultivate it out. Study to show thyself a. You see where the scripture begins to come together there? See, it's already there, brother, but God can't give it to you till you're ready.
but it's there. And as much as you want, you can have. But it is associated to how you die to self. The more that you die to the Harlequin Woe romance, the more that you die to the Taylor County News, the more that you die to ESPN, the more that you die to all these sports magazines and love magazines and fashion magazines and housekeeping magazines and start reading the Word, that's when you begin to grow. Amen. That's when God begins to honor you with knowledge. Knowledge that only God can give. You know, I think about heaven and all the beauties of heaven, and I can't wait to see my mansion. I'm looking forward to seeing it. I'm looking, well, I should say my place.
Yeah, amen.
Because if we take the scripture in context, he said, in my Father's house are many mansions. He said, but I go to prepare a place for you. Meaning he's going to prepare a place especially designed, moi. That means me, amen. That means me. I mean a place designed just for me on the street of glory. But God says, he gives us, you know, I think about the beauties of heaven, but what I yearn for the most is the knowledge. I hunger for the knowledge. I hunger to know how. Right now they say the earth is spinning at 19 miles an hour, but I can't feel it. Amen? How's it hanging up there in space like that? I know some of you smarter than I am. Y'all could probably give me a good answer, but I ain't listening to you. I want to hear from God. You may have a PhD and an HHD and all kinds of D's. I don't know, but I really want to hear from God. Because you've been taught by man, and I want to be taught by it. There you go. See, I yearn for that. Hunger for that knowledge, that understanding. Yearn. Because see, Jesus is the Word. He didn't say Jesus is a diamond. Jesus is gold. He said Jesus is the Word. Word gives us knowledge, understanding. What did Jesus use on the devil? The Word. Satan can't handle the Word. He can't handle the Word. So we bring this to a close. The Bible says, if any man serve me, him will my Father honor. Now is my soul troubled. And what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. But for this cause I came unto this hour. I'm a chosen generation. Why should I be praying for God to save me from this hour? Why should I be praying that? For this hour, God put me here, and he put you here. You're a chosen generation. He didn't pick Peter, James, and John. He didn't pick Mary. He didn't pick Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of Jesus. He didn't pick Ruth and Naomi. He picked us. So what that tells me, that if I'm a chosen generation, and God chose me for this time and this hour, then God considers me that I have the ability to be able to handle it. And that I can fight the good fight of faith. And that tells me that right now as I look at this section and that section and that section and that section, then I see men of the caliber of Peter and Paul and James and John and Isaiah and Ezekiel and Jeremiah. And then I see women of the caliber of Ruth and Naomi and Sarah and Hannah. I mean, great women of the Bible. I mean, I see what God sees. See, Satan has blinded you and I. And we don't understand who we are in Jesus. But the Bible says that we are more than conquerors. We are more than conquerors. We are overcomers. But a lot of God's people don't see themselves the way God sees them. But you got to begin to see yourself. And see, it all happens through the first fruit. See, the world did not see the true Jesus until he was resurrected from the grave. And one day, we're going to stand before the true Jesus. The Bible says that our works are going to be judged so as by fire. Wood, hay, stubble, gold, silver, precious stones, and they're going to be put through the fire. Whatever survives the fire, you're rewarded for.
Wood, hay, or stubble don't survive. Only gold, silver, precious stones survive. Revelation chapter 1 gives us a picture of Jesus with the eyes as a flame of fire. That when he looks at you, Brother Jamie, everything that you've done that was with wrong motives is gone. Only what was genuine will remain. And that's the reason why we have to work on why we do what we do. And it has to be genuine. And the motivation has to be love. Love for God and love for mankind. Love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, thy soul, thy mind, and thy strength. And love thy neighbor as thyself. We have to have the right motives. It's not about whether I'm going to impress Brother Brian. It's not matter whether I'm going to get in leadership. We do it for the right reason. It's not a matter of whether they're going to put my name on the marquee. We do it for the right reasons. And those are the things that will survive. Church, there's first fruits. I'm going to tell you right now, you cannot cover first fruits in 13 days. 13 days, you're going to get a compilation and a combination of messages and words that's being downloaded to you by mighty men of God. You are. But really and truly, they're just giving you the surface of this thing. You have got to get in the Word and study it for yourself and see what thus saith the Lord. First fruits. First fruits. God wants you to understand first fruits. As we go back, let me give this to you. Remember, the Bible says, remember the Lord's death till he comes. Jesus is the first fruits. The celebration of the first fruits was as they gave it to Jesus and they celebrated recognizing God as their provider. God meeting all their needs. The reason why Jesus is the first fruits is through him salvation is provided. Provided that we can thank God that he sent his son to die on the cross so that we could be saved. And he provided a way and a means for us to be born again and birthed into the family of God. Not anything that I have done, but all that he has did. Listen, it ain't me, it ain't anything I done other than receive the free gift of salvation when it was afforded to me, when it was given to me. Because Jesus Christ, when he said it is finished on the cross of Calvary, he finished it.
Yes, he did.
He finished it.
Yes, he did.
He finished it. He finished it. You can't add anything to it. You can't take nothing away from it. He is the first fruits. And see,
come on, Jeff.
Oh my goodness. Let me give you this. Whew, glory to Jesus.
Bring it on.
Remember the scripture says that a woman, a Hebrew woman, was blessed if a male child opened her womb. Remember that? Let me give you the significance of that. Blessed is the man or woman when a man child opens your womb, your heart. Jesus. You can only be saved by Jesus. Nobody else can save you. Nobody else can open up your heart. So when they start preaching there's other ways and means to heaven, they're lying. Because he opened up the womb of your heart. A man child opened up that womb. And then the Bible even talks about circumcision as being a covenant. The Bible says then our hearts get circumcised. That God knows those that are his. God knows whose hearts belong to him. And I hope everybody I'm looking at right now, does your heart belong to Jesus? Really, does your heart belong to Jesus? Because this ain't something to play around with. You either are or you're not. You're either heaven bound or hell bound. I don't know which road you're on, but I know which one I'm on. But do you love Jesus, really? Really, do you love Jesus? What about this group over here? Do you love Jesus? Do you really love Jesus? Is he in your heart? Have you made him Lord of your life? I'm not talking about Savior. Maybe you've made him Savior. But have you made him Lord? Is he the one ruling and reigning? Is he the one calling the shots? What about this section? Y'all love Jesus?
Yes,
sir.
Don't y'all lie to me. Do y'all love Jesus?
Yes, sir.
Because I'm going to tell you something. I'm either a witness for you or I'm a witness against you. So I'm trying to take a mental picture in my mind right now. Because God knows if you're lying to me. God knows if you're lying to Him. Do you love Jesus?
Yes, sir.
Then you better be following Him. Then I don't want to hear any excuses.
That's right.
Do you love Jesus over here?
Yes.
Do you love the Lord?
Yes.
Are you going to serve Him? You're going to follow Him? Listen to me. Once again, I'm trying to make a mental picture. And I know that in this body, I can't remember all y'all's faces. But in the spirit, it's there.
Amen.
Click, click, click. Amen. I'm getting it all. Click, click, click. Click, 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 click. I'm getting it all. Amen. Whew. Amen. Hallelujah. It's all in there now. So I'm either going to be a witness for you or a witness against you. You are here tonight to hear this word. See, God knew I was going to be coming back third night. God knew the word you needed to hear. Now you're responsible for it. Woo! I'm glad you are, amen. I'm glad you are, praise God. I've laid it down on you. The ball's in your court, and you do something with it, praise Jesus. Hallelujah. Woo! Hallelujah! 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 Woo! Come in here with not a burden, a responsibility, but I done laid it down, and I done laid it on you. You carry it now. You do something with it now. Hallelujah, because Jesus said, take my yoke upon you and learn of me. Then you'll find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy. My yoke is easy. It's not hard, brother, to serve the Lord. It's not hard to serve with the Lord. It's not hard. My yoke is easy. Amen? And my burden is light. Thank you, Lord, for your precious word. Thank you for your sweet Holy Spirit, the sweet presence of the Holy Ghost. Lord, I'm so thankful. Lord, we come into your presence. Lord, sometimes we just don't know what to expect. But Lord, we come expecting. Lord, we know that there's going to be days that, Lord, you're just going to pour out that warmth and that love upon us. Lord, we're going to feel that joy in the Holy Ghost. And Lord, we're just going to want to dance before the Lord. And Lord, then there's times you pour that Spirit out upon us, that anointing begins to rise up inside of us. And Lord, we feel like that we're ready to run out the doors and slap the devil up aside the head and say, hey, I'm taking back my family. I'm taking back my loved ones. And Lord, that anointing begins to rise up inside of us. And then Lord, that anointing begins to rise up inside of us. And then there's sometimes you said, just be still. Just be still. Just be still. Oh Lord, there's just so many ways that you meet with us and you talk to us, Lord, and you strengthen us. And Lord, tonight we've given them another message on first fruits, dear God. I mean, directly from you to them. Lord, this was a download into this church, dear God. Lord, they got an app now for this, amen. They've got it, Lord Jesus. They've got it. And so, Lord, I pray that they're checking that application out every time they get a chance, Lord. Pulling it up on their phone, pulling it up on their computers. I'm talking about spiritually, Lord. And learning more about how to use it, how to activate it, how to make it work for them, Lord Jesus. And I just pray you'll bless this time of invitation. Lord, I just know the word says that except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it remaineth alone. And I know that there's people in here tonight that could not raise their hand if I asked them to, acknowledging to me that they had led at least one person to Jesus. So Lord, we're going to give them a chance. If they really, 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 Lord, want to lead somebody to Jesus, then they're going to have to come and ask. They're going to have to come at this cross, and they're going to have to get down and say, Lord, I've never led anybody to Jesus, but you know my heart, and I want to. I want to lead somebody to Christ. It may be a friend. It may be a relative. They're going to have to ask. And Lord, maybe there's some here that have led one, but Lord, it's been a while since they have done anybody else. They need to come up here and say, Lord, I'm ready for number two or number three. They need to come and ask. And I just believe, Lord, that if they come, that, Lord, you're going to put people in their path beginning right after this service.
Yeah.
Into tomorrow. And throughout the rest of this week and through the rest of their lives. It's going to be that powerful, Lord, that it's going to carry through the rest of their days. And that they're going to become soul winners, because you said, he that winneth souls is wise. Mm-hmm. And you're in the soul business.
Yeah.
You're in the soul-saving, life-changing business. Yeah. You are in it to win it, to win souls. And so, Lord, whether they're young, whether they're old, we got little ones in here that can lead people to Jesus. They just need to ask. So, Lord, as we have this invitation, you say we have not because we ask not. But whatever we ask believing, we shall receive.
That's right.
We shall receive. Thank you, Lord. As your heads are bowed and your eyes are closed, and as these our folks are already ready to begin to lead us into this time of invitation. You know where the cross is at. You know what you need to do. This is between you and the Lord right now.